to Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guest today, Ursula Martins, has written her autobiography. It is a book that disturbs and expresses truth, as well as how one can take a child and give them the lies that Adolf Hitler did, and they will believe them until. The book is called Stations Along the Way, The Spiritual Transformation of Former Hitler Youth Leader, Ursula Martins. She's written it with Mark Shaw. And welcome, Ursula.
Welcome.
It is a book that, as I said, it disturbs, because had you not had exposure to change, you might have still be indoctrinated with the cult of Adolf Hitler.
Yes, I'm sure I would have.
Start with where you were born and the fact your father was the head of the railroad wherever you were located.
Yeah, I was born in a small town close to the Baltic Sea, and my father was station master, which meant he was in charge of whatever station we were living, and the stations got bigger and bigger, not necessarily the cities, but the stations mm-hmm. were more important, more trains going back and forth in different directions. And we always lived in the top of the station was always our apartment, yeah. And it usually had a big balcony, the length of the, and it kind of was a, in smaller towns, it was the center of the town where there was usually like a marketplace in front of it. Yep. And people were going in and out all day.
And you have a sister, an older sister.
My sister was 5 years older than yeah. I, yeah, Evie.
Are you still in touch with her?
No, she died.
She died.
Yeah.
Because it was like you were chocolate and vanilla, totally different mm-hmm. people.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But this was growing up in an era that even, I suppose it was not unlike in England, where parents did not hold, hug, or kiss children too much.
That's right, and the part of Germany that I come from, it's called Mecklenburg, the state, those people were even more stoic and didn't yeah. party a lot and didn't show affection.
Yeah, very religious people?
Kind of, it was all Lutheran.
Yeah.
It was all Lutheran, the state was Lutheran, and we were told that if you wanted to run for office and you didn't have that religion, you didn't even have a chance.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah. Growing up, let's talk about Nuremberg, the riots, Kristallnacht, mm-hmm. and you are a little girl who is in Adolf Hitler. He's the handsome new leader.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. When I was 4 years old, he became chancellor. And till today, I remember that day. How excited everybody was, and everybody was gathering at the railroad station, and they had loudspeakers because people didn't have radio at that time, or not as many. Mm-hmm. And everybody was excited, and I saw the what they call the blue coats. That was kind of like his gang, yeah. Hitler's gang, the first ones that were there. I saw them march in, and they came up to our house and put a picture of him on the balcony and had flags furled mm-hmm. down the on each side. And the reason I remember it, they had big lights, spotlights, but they also put two little lamps that my parents had in their on their nightstands. They put those to shine in his face. So I always remember those lamps with the silk screening around it. So, and we went outside and everybody was excited, and they were talking about Nazi and communist and all that. And my mother, and I asked my mother, what's a Nazi? And she says, and she told me Nazis are good people and the communists are bad people. So that was my first.
Yeah. I held up a picture. Your grandparents were not quite that indoctrinated.
No, they weren't. Especially my grandfather, he was very open about it, and that could have gotten him in a lot of trouble.
Mm-hmm.
And even there was a time once when the Kristallnacht, mm-hmm. after the Kristallnacht, we visited my grandparents, and we were all sitting around the table eating, and kids weren't supposed to talk so much. You know, they were supposed to be seen but not heard. And my mother asked my grandmother, did they hit any stores here? And she said, yes, they did. And she couldn't understand why. And those were good people, she was saying. And I got up and I said, oh, we really did it to them. You know, I wanted to show them that we did the right thing. And my grandfather got very upset about it and said, you know, like, shut up and you know, mind your own business. But I kind of, I don't know if I hated him, but I really was angry at him that he could make such a remark, you know, about
what was
wrong.
Well, you were 10 years old, and
but
you
I was,
were
yeah,
a smart, yeah, you know, yeah, a smarty yeah, pants yeah, Alec yeah, at yeah, that yeah, point. Yeah, and to think of you talking back to your grandfather,
right,
and I'm sure at school they were telling you, you can turn your parents in.
That's right, yes.
Yeah.
Yes,
do they
yes,
know a
yeah,
Jew?
Yes, yes. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And I would have, I probably would have, if I would have had a real reason to do, maybe not my parents, but I would have turned in people that... That's what I was told, and that was my duty to do.
Yeah. Tell me about Jacob and the dog.
Oh, that was when we were living in a bigger city. My father was no longer station master, then he worked in the office, in the district office. We were living close. There was a lot of lakes around, and we all lived close to a lake. And one day when I came home, I don't know, from school or something, there was a man sitting on a bench with a dog, and I couldn't resist dogs ever in my life. And he was making the dog jump over a stick, and so I just stood and watched him, and he asked me to come closer, and he showed me tricks he could do. He could count the dog and all that. And so we talked a little while, and then he gave me a dime and said that we could meet in the afternoon, and we would go to a more deserted place by the lake, and he would show me more tricks than the dog. He could go in the water and fetch a stick and all that. So I went home all excited and told my mother that what had happened. Mm-hmm. And she got all excited and called my father home from work.
Yeah.
And we didn't have a phone then. People didn't have phones like that. She went downstairs to our landlord and asked to use the phone. And my father came home, which was very unusual. And he asked me. And then I knew already I was in trouble a little bit, so I didn't make the story as urgent. But then two people came in a car. That was unusual, too, in a big black car. And they got out and asked me again the same story. And they were something like secret police in civilian clothes. And they asked me to be there at that same time to show them the men. And then when they came, and we drove to the where we were supposed to meet. And I didn't have to do anything. I just stayed in the car. They asked me, is that the man? And I said, yes. And they got out. Another car came, and they took him and took the dog. And
but the next day, his fiancée came,
and she came up. My mother didn't even let her in because we were told to be careful when people spoke with an accent. You know, those were foreigners, and
so
to be
you
careful.
Really never knew what happened
no,
to him.
No. But I'm sure they took him. You know, he had an accent. He was a foreigner. He might have been from Poland or you know.
Earlier though. You had also had a thing with the boy at school who was a little retarded.
Well, yeah, that was my kind of friend.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
But at that time, I wasn't quite as indoctrinated yet. You know,
he
was kind of, my mother said he was retarded.
Yeah.
And he wanted to hang out with my girlfriend and I. We kind of took care of him so the other kids wouldn't bully him. He later on, he became our friend. We cleaned animal cages together, and we were kind of, he always followed us around. And one time he followed us to the railroad station where my father still was in a railroad station. And we didn't let him in because I know my parents wouldn't allow him in the house.
And also because this was under Hitler.
Yeah.
Someone who they would have destroyed.
Yeah. Well, that I realized later on. Now, he was my retarded friend, and he got killed in an accident with the trains close to by my house. And later on, we were taught that it was like animal kingdom, that people that weren't healthy, they weren't worth living. Yeah. And we used to put cats in a sack and with stones and drown them. That was the way you got rid of extra cats or dogs or whatever. And I thought, and then I kind of had the understanding that's, you know, people that weren't totally Aryan,
yeah,
that they would have to, they shouldn't live.
Bizarre. You know, coming and of feeling that I too could have been murdered, it's mm-hmm. hard to understand. Mm-hmm. Let's go further. What, in high school, after high school, didn't you, wasn't this also with Hitler's Liebes for girls to go mm-hmm. and be impregnated?
Well, that I didn't really know about. That,
yeah.
All those things, I read books after the war,
yeah.
and I read about it. We really didn't have a bad life. We would go, we had free theater tickets, free yeah. opera tickets. We had could go to movies free yeah. in groups.
Well, you were
with
upscale.
Our group.
Yeah, I mean, uh-huh, it was...
Right. So we didn't have a bad life. We had food. We were, yeah. Living happily. My parents had a yacht that they would, we
yeah.
would go out. We had a kind of normal life. But then you heard those little things, and everywhere there were signs, enemy is living, is listening.
Mm-hmm.
Don't speak, and the enemy is living. Everywhere you were very careful what you said to strangers.
Yeah.
So, and I don't know what, I never talked to my parents. It was accepted that I belonged to the, 10 years old, I belonged to the party, and I was excited about it. And sure, there were people coming, telling us that, what the Nazi party stood for and what they wanted to do. But it was never close to home. I'd never heard it until the time that I came home from a meeting, and I saw, well, there were talk about mm-hmm. Internment camps, but
yeah.
we kind of thought of them as where people that were against the government would be
yeah. Well, you came across something in your father's desk.
Yeah, that was also in that same city where, when, that was before that. I saw a train, and when we were still living, when I was living with my grandparents, I came home, and it was kind of dark. It was snowing, and I heard a dog bark. And again, the dog. I had to go and yeah. see the dog. And as I went closer, it was in the railroad station. There were two trains, and they were. And then I heard the dogs barking, and mm-hmm. I saw people get out of the with the SS people there, and with guns, and they were ordering the people to go from one side of the train to another
yeah.
train on the other side. And I saw the uniform, and that was the first time when I kind of felt there is truth to the rumors I hear, because these were. I couldn't even tell if they were men or women, because they were all had their hair shaved, and they had black
yeah.
and white striped clothes
yeah.
on. Yeah. So I kind of had a little bit, and I ran home, and I didn't tell anybody about it, but that was the first time when I had a little doubt
mm-hmm.
Of what was going on.
Yeah. Well, the Nazis lose the war. Where are you as the bombs are falling?
Well, when